Hebrew Vision Live. Hebrew Vision Live. I'm your host, Mikael Corbin Yahoo, aka the End Time Scribe. You just heard our theme song for Hebrew Vision Live, Let My People Go, by none other than Nakiabat Yahuda featuring Nakamia, Yaleach, and Corbin Yahoo. As always, we want to open with the Kaddish D'Rabbanan, the Rabbi's Kaddish, and we'll get into preliminaries about this evening's dynamic show. So with that, in the spirit of prayer, hallelujah. Yit gadol va yit kadesh, shemei rabba. B'almadi barak herotei v'ayimelech malkutei. B'chayechun uv'yamichun uv'chayei. D'kol beit Yisrael bagala v'izman kariv v'imeru. Amen. Yehei shemei rabba mavorach le'olam ulmei almaya. Yit barak v'yistabach. V'yit pa'ar v'yit roman v'yit nasei. V'yitadar, v'yitalei, v'yitalal, sh'meidu kudusha berichu. Le'elah min kol barakata v'ashirata, tush bechata v'nechmata, damiran ba'ama, v'imeru, amen. Al Israel ve'al Rabbanan, ve'al tamedei hon, ve'al kol tamedei tamedei hon, ve'al kol mandas akin borita, di batarach edein, v'di akol b'cho atar v'yatar, yehe lachon ochon shlama rabah, hine v'chasti davarach amin, v'chayin arakin, umzana roicha, ufar kanamen kadam abahundi bashamaya, v'imeru amen. Yehe shlama rabah me shamaya, v'chayim tovim aleinu, v'yal kol Israel v'imeru amen. Osei shalom b'imromav, hu barachamav yasei shalom aleinu. Yaaqov Israel, Yimiru, amen. Magnified and sanctified may his great name be in the world he created by his will. May he establish his kingdom in your lifetime and in your days and in the lifetime of all the house of Israel, swiftly and soon. And let us say, amen. May his great name be blessed forever and all time. Blessed and praised, esteemed and exalted, raised and honored, uplifted and lauded be the name of the Holy One. Blessed be he. Beyond any blessing, song, praise, and consolation uttered in the world, and let us say amen. To Israel, to the teachers, their disciples, and their disciples' disciples, and to all who engage in the study of Torah, here or elsewhere, may there come to them in you great favor, peace, kindness, grace, and compassion, long life, ample sustenance, and deliverance from their Our Father in heaven, and let us say amen. May there be great peace from heaven and good life for us, and all the house of Israel, and let us say amen. May he who makes peace in his high places, in his compassion, make peace for us and all the house of Israel, and let us say amen. Yes, indeed, hallelujah. So this evening, we have a pre-recorded interview with the brother out of Atlanta by the name of J.C. and Debo Hughes. Tonight, we will be discussing the African cultural and genetic dynamics of Israel. A very, very significant and important topic to discuss as relates to the root and the origin and the true identity and depiction and portrayal and appearance of the people of Israel. So without any further ado, I present to you all the African cultural and genetic dynamic of Israel with JC. And Debo Hughes. Hallelujah. You're listening live to Hebrew Vision. I'm here this evening with Brother J.C. and Debo Hughes. Shalom Aleichem, Maki. How you doing this evening?
Aleichem Shalom, bro.
Hallelujah. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule and being with us this evening, man. I know that I see you on Facebook doing a lot of things. ATL, you're in Atlanta, right?
Yep, I recently moved here last year around the same time.
Okay, big up, man, big up. Doing big things with your culinary arts, man. I commend you for that. We definitely need some. You're a vegan chef, too, right?
When I first moved here, I was a vegan chef.
Wow, okay.
That was the first job I got here.
Just evolving into the entire culinary art. That's what's up.
Right. I started cooking when I was 12.
Okay.
So I started off as a pastry chef.
Okay. That's what's up. So where's home originally for you, Art?
I'm originally from Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Okay. Bruce City. Shape, some form, some fashion. Yes, indeed. So with your upbringing, man, what's your background as far as, you know, culturally, spiritually, religiously? How were you raised? And then walk us into your coming into consciousness with the truth and with the word of the Most High.
Okay. Well, growing up, my family's really like my mother's side were pastors. early 1800s, late 1700s. Wow. And they were passed. So that's kind of in my blood to like want to learn the Bible and stuff like that from that perspective. When I was in school, I want to say middle school.
High school that you had this background and this upbringing, or was it middle school?
That was middle school. During high school, well, all my life, I always had an interest in history. I wouldn't necessarily say African history, but history in general, like history and science. That's what I did. Like, when I come home from school, I don't watch like cartoons. I watch the History Channel, you know, and stuff like that. So, and my dad, he was really big into history and science. So, we spent a lot of our time together, like, watching the History Channel, you know what I'm saying? He's really intellectual, so we watched a lot of Jeopardy and stuff like that. So,
yeah.
That's where I began to, like, want to learn more. But I didn't really think about the history in respect to my history, not just history in general. I just started focusing on history, my history. After high school, maybe like a year after high school. I'm 30 right now.
Okay. So when did you start getting into more of the Hebraic Israelite elements of your identity?
I want to say around the ages of like 19 or 20.
Okay. So what exposed you to that? How did you come to that particular awareness in light of all of the other Pan-African? Because that's not even, you know, element that's expressed in Pan-Africanism when you're dealing with Israelite consciousness. That's really marginal. You know, how did you come into that particular aspect of our history?
This is one day I was, to surfing the internet, and I came across, I want to say GOCC, and I saw a video they did, because, like, you know, I was searching FEMA caps, and GOCC did a video on FEMA caps, and I'm like, let me watch that video, it's some black. it's a wrap. Like, this is gonna be a wrap. It's gonna be a knockout. And that's exactly what it was.
He destroyed Seti.
That was a turning point.
Right. He destroyed Seti in that debate. But I understand, historically, no Israelite camp or individual could really refute some of the information that Seti was bringing at that time, or just that whole, you know, comedic community.
Right, that's true.
When Nasi came on the scene, I mean, it completely revolutionized everything as relates to the Israelite consciousness. And then brothers such as yourself, brother Divine Prospect, Zion Lex, you know, y'all start coming to the forefront, and it presented a whole new dynamic as relates to the Israelite consciousness. So that's huge, man. That's huge. So I can see that being defining. This is just kind of a... Go ahead.
Divine Prospect, too. Brother Divine Prospect, too. Like, during that same time period, that's when I found out about Divine Prospect. He was doing a live show on Signetta about being a pandemic Hebrew. At the time period, the people I knew, because Divine wasn't really out there like that. The people that I knew and knew me, they thought Divine Prospect was me. They calling me like, hey, man, you on Signetta TV? I'm like, I'm at home. Man, it's a dude on side of the TV saying the exact same thing you're talking about. So I tuned in, and I'm like, man, this brother, man, I'm like, dog, this brother is true. I'm like, I got to call him. I got to contact him. I got contact with him. From that point forward, man, that's my bro. That's my bro right there.
Y'all connect in ATL, right? He's in ATL, too, isn't he?
Yeah. He's one of the, him and the other brother. Brother Brian, you know, Brother Yosef, my brother Randall, Josh, you know, a lot of brothers down here, man.
So, if I'm not mistaken, you all are identified as the RBG Hebrews, correct?
Yes, indeed.
Okay, so talk about that formation. How does this come about? What are the RG Hebrews? How do you all connect? What is you all's mission?
Okay, let me address one thing.
Yes, sir.
A lot of Hebrews who don't subscribe to anything African, no matter what it be. A lot of them assume that this is something that we created, that we made up.
Right.
But if they really did their history on the culture that they're claiming, to see that the original, you know, people in the forefront of the movement from the beginning were Pan African. I'm talking about people like Martin R. Delaney. That's in the 1800s. Mm-hmm. He's considered to be the father of Black nationalism. You know what I'm saying? One of the first people to advocate to go back to Africa. Not only go back to Africa, but in his own words, to build restore Israel. He said that as all mouth in the 1800s. He was his mother, his father was a slave, and his mother was free. So, you know, and he was a smart brother. He went to Harvard, one of the first African Americans to go to an elite college. I believe it was Harvard. You know, he fought in the war to free the slaves. He was a deep brother. You know what I'm saying? So, he wasn't crazy. Same goes for even when you go down to the early 1900s, you had the UNIA, the Hebrew Israelites of that time period. They were one of Marcus Garvey's biggest supporters. Most of his generals and most of his the people he put in prominent positions were quote unquote Black generals.
Josiah Ford.
Start this, but how our particular group got together was, like I was explaining my relationship with my prospect, we basically have the same outlook on things when it comes to Africa.
said, what is the objective and the mission of the RBG Hebrew group?
The main objective is to bring our people together, no matter what you follow, whether it be Islam, from the comedic perspective, no matter, as long as you're able to put whatever you believe aside.
That exist amongst us as an African people in the diaspora, more specifically in North America, in the United States. You know, there's a lot of even contention and divisiveness. What would you suggest would be, you know, the basic common denominator that would unite us as a people? How would we go about achieving this unity that RBG Hebrews set as their mission? In your perspective?
I would say less talking and more people leading by example. And we can't really focus on trying to gather all our people or a large number of people. It's just we have to gather enough and reach enough people to make an effective change. That's it. They can be as little as 800 of our people.
Right.
Who are all doing the same thing in unison. So you don't really need to be this big global, you know what I'm saying, mass thing. You don't have to be that way.
Okay. You see even the remnant, so to speak, as being an essential element, establishing a remnant consciousness that would allow for this unity to take place by walking more so than talking.
Exactly. And that's the same concept as the black liberation college. Mm-hmm. So it was so easy for them to take different precepts in the Bible and marry it to what they were doing. Because it's the same concept that Christ and the disciples had. Mm-hmm. You know, he had many disciples. It was just the 12 were the most active to put in the most work. That's what you hear about. You don't hear about the thousands of other ones he had.
Right.
You're probably just talking about, you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, I follow Christ. Oh, yeah. You know what I'm saying? We do this, we do that. But never did anything. You know what I'm saying? So it took a little less 12 at some time. You know what I'm saying? It don't really take to make a splash.
Right.
You drop a penny.
How do you personally identify yourself within the national identity of an Israelite? How do you identify and why?
Okay. My perspective of, before I get into that, my perspective of being a Hebrew Israelite, or being an Israelite,
yes, sir.
My perspective in regards to the culture that we follow and accept now as being Israelite culture is the byproduct of millenniums of redactions, people tearing the customs and the culture to fit their time period, which is not, there's nothing wrong with that. You gotta grow and expand, you know what I'm saying, and contract as time goes on.
Right.
But we're following We're following the byproduct of millenniums of doing that. And that goes back to the time of King Hezekiah, when he was waging reforms on the various practices that the Israelites did. He didn't find to be right for political reasons.
down on that.
Yeah, Moses and the rod. Moses and the rod, he put the serpent on. When that miracle happened, that sign from the Most High happened, the Israelites took that and it became a symbol of Israel. It was King Hezekiah who came in and demonized him, got rid of him. The Most High didn't tell him to do that. The Most High didn't tell him to do that. You know what I'm saying? But then we had to figure out who's writing the narrative, who's speaking. The people that were writing the narrative at the time period was his own scribe. So, of course, they're not going to say anything bad about him within the text. It's going to be the most righteous that have been lived. You know, he did this and he did that. They're not going to talk about the fact that he was uprooting a custom and a practice that was, you know what I'm saying, indicative of Israel. Like, no other culture could claim it. You know what I'm saying? So,
very interesting.
That's where I stand there when it comes to that. So, I go back, and I'm in the process of right now of reclaiming the old ancient African roots of what we follow today. Give our people a more decolonized version, whether it be decolonized from European culture or decolonized from corrupt leaders in our own past communities and past communities, whether it be Josiah.
Ask you something in light of that. When you look at the reforms of, like you say, Hezekiah and Josiah, you know, we're dealing with, if I'm not mistaken, is this pre-exilic times or is this post-exilic times?
That's pre-exilic.
Okay, we're dealing with pre-exilic Israel. We're dealing, however,
Hezekiah.
The Assyrians
who were pressing them,
right?
Trying to get them to. They had a treaty with them. Israel had a treaty with Egypt, and the Assyrians were trying to get them to side with them.
Okay. Right.
Even within that story context, the king of Assyria was talking to one of Hezekiah's men, and Hezekiah sent out. Syria. And the king told the guy that Hezekiah took out and sent out to talk to him. He told him, okay, you claim to worship this God, yet your own king is destroying the temples and the monuments of this God you claim to worship. But yet you defended him. You know what I'm saying? A foreign person. So caught up in the political military tactics that Hezekiah was using on us, and we didn't see that.
Very interesting.
He was destroying these temples and these holy places and taking the bricks and making walls and stuff. He was taking the gold fixtures and doors off of temples and giving it to the king of Assyria. So the king of Assyria really didn't have initiative in telling the guy that. He was getting the gold from him. You know what I'm saying? He didn't really have anything invested. But to tell him, look, the God you claim you worship, you're letting your king destroy the temple. What makes you think he's going to fight? What makes you think he's driving to fight with you if you allow him to do it?
Very interesting.
People always wonder, they ask, where's the artifacts of Israel? Where's this, where's that? You got crazy kings who
maybe we'll let's come back to that. I don't want to, you know, just set that aside because I do find that very interesting. I'm familiar with some of your work, some of the statements you've made in light of that, dealing with even the female aspects of divinity within Israel. We'll come back to that as well. So let's talk about now your identity, though. How do you identify? Because I understand there's some things that you've undertaken genetically, DNA-wise, that have yielded some interesting results for you, and it has impacted you in a very significant way. Can you address that for us, please?
Genetically, I am Igbo. And the DNA test really didn't tell me that. It kind of confirmed what
okay.
I already knew.
Okay.
My ancestors were enslaved by President Thomas Jefferson. Even though he was a wicked person, the Most High put it in his heart to actually write down the slave name and where he came from. He kept bringing up in the Bible. So my ancestors were held as slaves there in this plantation. Long story short, one of my ancestors, Lewis Hughes, he wrote an autobiography around 1871 of his life of him being a slave. It's called 30 Years a Slave by Lewis Hughes.
Are you in possession of that document?
Excuse me?
Are you in possession of that document?
I plead the fifth. I went to the public library of my city, and I was doing research, like I told you before, around that age where you want to know where you come from. So I went to the public library, and I went to the historical section, where you have, you know, they put the white gloves on, and you go get the dusty books and stuff like that. And I happened to run across this book, and at this point, my family knew nothing about this book, that it even existed. And right there in their library, I read the book. And when I was reading the book, some of the stories he was telling made a light bulb go off my head, because I remember my grandmother telling me stories when I was growing up, like specific stories. But she had the story handed down to her from her mother, and her mother from her mother. So by the time it got to me, it wasn't all the way there. Like some names missing, you know, certain details are missing.
Right.
But when I read his book, all that fell into place. Like I knew right away.
No, go ahead. I don't mean to cut you off. Go ahead and finish your thought up.
Yeah, but during that time period, that's the same. Well, when I was growing up, my grandma would tell me that her mother would tell them that they were evil. They always had a weird name. They didn't know whether it was Native American. They didn't know what it was. They just know that she will always reinforce. They didn't have a geological location in their head of where it was at or who it was.
Right.
So I was when I discovered, oh, she was talking about the Igbo tribe, West Africa.
Wow.
So when I did the DNA test, it just confirmed what I already knew.
So how has your family received that, you know, revelation? In light of everything that you've been going through and you're telling them, you know, this is who we are, what we will, how have they received that revelation?
My grandma, she was skeptical when it came to the book. She was like, no, you know, just because the guy has our, you know what I'm saying, he got my last name, don't mean that he's our ancestor. There's a lot of people with the last name you. You just can't go off of that. Whatever like that. And she made a valid point. It was a very valid point. But when I showed her the book, and she's reading the story, me, he's going into greater detail and giving actual names instead of nicknames. Mm-hmm. She was blown away.
My goodness.
When it comes to the Israelite perspective, my mother, she didn't accept it right away.
Mm-hmm.
She rejected it for some years. But then she ended up accepting it. But pretty much my family was spread out across Nigeria. And they carry their coach with them. Now, some people will tell you that they aren't Israelites whatsoever. But then you have some people that tell you they are evil whatsoever. Because they're ashamed of evil.
What's the shame? What's the shame?
They're ashamed to be evil based off of the prejudice that evil people face in Nigeria.
Oppression.
As far
suffering.
As, yeah, like the Hausa, Fulani in Europe were the cult behind the Biafran War, where a lot of evil got, it was worse. You know, that's the evil equivalent of the Holocaust. So,
are they the minority in Nigeria? Are the Igbo the minority group culturally or ethnically?
I wouldn't say the minority group, but from a culture standpoint, they stand out. That's why they call them the Jews of Nigeria, because they're in every facet of the infrastructure. And that was one of the main issues they had. House of Europe dominated government, that people were everywhere. You know what I'm saying? They were in the train station, they were in the government, you know, they were everywhere. They didn't like that. So, a war ensued. That war was basically puppeted by Great Britain, anyway. That's why you see a lot of Nigerians with the Biafran flag, and they don't call themselves Nigerians. Nigeria is a government. It's man-made. It's a man-made state.
Wow. So, Gad. The Igbo are descended from Gad, is what you said?
Yes, according to them.
Okay.
This is true.
So
according to some of them, this is true.
So how... migration of Gad. What is understood is how did Gad, the son, I believe he said his name is Giri. What inspired or what motivated his migration from Northeast Africa, which is what Israel is, to Western Africa?
There's several different narratives of how he got there and why he left.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not really keyed in on one particular one.
Okay.
But historical standpoint, outside of the Igbo, there's records of a guy named Eldad.
Okay.
You read from Babylon and Timbuktu.
Right.
You wouldn't know the book.
Right.
During the Middle Ages. Time period, he had a lot of quote unquote Jews or Israelites in Morocco.
Right.
And he came, he told them that there's other Israelites all across Africa. And he was given the names of the tribes, Zebulon, Gad, Tali. He was like, they have kingdoms in below the Sahara, sub Saharan Africa. He was telling them that.
Wow.
So, it would have been no way to had the information. So, from their cultural memory, they had the stories passed down to them that Gad came there. But then you have historical record of a man from the Middle Ages going to Morocco saying the exact same thing. And he said that it happened during 700 BC. He said it was two. He said 700 BC. It happened during 700 BC, and it happened during the split between Jeroboam and Rehoboam. You got separate ones. The best sources to get on anything Israelite and African or West African would be any Middle Age to learn from there. So I know a lot of people, a lot of black conscious community, they try to discredit the extra biblical research we have on the Israelites in Africa by saying, oh, white man made that up because he wanted to convert people to Christianity. Well, guess what? The white man was getting this information from people who were there 500 years prior to him. They had no clue what was going on below the Sahara before the 1400s. They had no clue. They couldn't even make it that far.
Right.
So they had no clue. Sacred tree they had. understand the history of West Africa, understand why he said, I'm Muslim, but I'm an Israelite, you would know that during that time period, the Middle Ages, a lot of West Africa spread into Islam.
By force, right?
Yeah, sometimes by force.
Right.
When Islam first came to West Africa, it wasn't something that the masses would give. It was that the leaders were practicing. Not because they were devoted Muslims, but they believed in Islam. It was to open up the trade routes further down the Sahara. The only way they could do that is to convert to Islam. Because within the Islamic tenets, some of the trades and commerce would be forbidden for Muslims to do. So if they got these West Africans to convert, they can handle that end of the trade that they couldn't do as it was prohibited by Islam. So within that same perspective, when the whole Silk Road thing popped off, the whole Silk Trade, Silk Road, it went from as far as China, right? You had Hebrews who were in West Africa who were trading goods with China and India for silk. They were taking this silk back to West Africa and making kente clothes.
Hebrew.
Yeah. The coats of many colors.
Right. Why do you think this segment of history or this aspect of history is not brought forth?
Because a lot of people put a lot of time and effort and money into it not being brought forth, and the whole existence of America, even economically, is based off their interpretation of our text. From the Pledge of Allegiance to God we trust, we put it on the money, their quote unquote moral fabric, we have this Christian identity and moral standard, you know what I'm saying? So it wouldn't be beneficial to them to expose that in the Western world. But when you go east, people know already. They know what's up, but they're not in the dark about that. You know what I'm saying? They're not in the dark about that. It's just us over here.
So speaking of us,
I was talking to one of my West African brothers, and he was like, "Yeah, man, we learned this stuff in school. Like in regular school, they learned this stuff in school about the Hebrew Israelites, about the migration, they learned all that stuff in school."
Now was he? West African non-Israelite?
He was from Ghana.
Okay.
And that's another thing, too. So let's address that. Since you brought it up. I know you pushed me to that direction. I know just let me address that. And that's one of the big issues when it comes to Hebrew Israelites. Because when I talk to people who are straight up anti African, anti-African. They say stinking Hamites and doodle-eating Hamites. They sold us to the white man. And they said all this irrational stuff. And I figured out a way, instead of arguing with them, I figured out a way to make them think. And think logically. And the way I did that was to ask them, you say the Hamites sold us slave trade. What West African tribe? We need a name. Tribe, clan, nation. What West African people were responsible for selling us to the white man who you're identifying as Hamite? What's their name today? Nobody can ever give me an answer. I'm like, okay, how are you condemning these people saying that they're stinking Hamites? They sold you to the white man. First thing they do is they run to a scripture, which they twist, take out of context to validate that. And as a historian, I'm not accepting that. We're having a historical conversation with me, and I'm giving you, I give you to your spiritual preference. I'm not going to debate you about your spiritual preference. You need to produce the articles to prove that these people are the people that you're accusing of committing one of the most heinous crimes ever in history. You just can't accuse somebody of that. Then be like, well, I don't know which one.
With no witnesses, you know, right?
Nothing. It's the same thing white people do to us. When they shoot us in the street, well, he looked like other Tyrone. Tyrone is Tyrone. I don't know. Whatever.
Right.
If he did it, then the rest of them did it. You know what I'm saying? No. I need a name. Since you don't have a name, let's do this. What West African kingdom is known for selling and capturing the most slaves? The anti-African Israelites, they would still say, yeah, there's Israelites in West Africa, but it's some Hamites too. And they would, well, the Ashanti, the Israelites. Okay, cool. The Ashanti Israelites, guess what? They were single-handedly responsible for the most slaves. So, but you're saying that the Israelites, but then you tell me that the Hamites sold you to the white man. Now, are the Ashanti Hamites? Or the Israelites? You just told me they were Israelites.
Right, make up your mind.
Right, so now you gotta read. When I ask that question, you gotta reanalyze your thinking. You don't have to go so far to even think that hard. Go back to the Bible. Israel is known for selling each other. What Joseph and his brothers do? What Joseph's brothers do to him? They sold him. But sure, they would sell each other for anything. There's even a clause within the Torah that tells you if you have a brother as a slave, after X amount of years, you have to let him go. You have to give him money. And if you stay, it's a whole provision to set up to regulate that because that was an issue in Israel.
Right. It wasn't perpetual. So, right. It wasn't perpetual. Unless they, contracted it to be.
Right. But they didn't want to leave.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So I'm like, if anything, that should be more proof to you. Of West African selling you, that should be more proof to you before they are. Not a thing where you always think Hamites, I hate them. They sold us. Except that. If you don't know, you can't name me. You can't name me three West African tribes. So who are you really? You're like, who are you really accusing of doing this? Can't be logical. Another thing when it comes to the Hamite. Israel, you all have, a lot of Israelites have Hebrew names. But unfortunately, a lot of people had a Hebrew name before they actually learned Hebrew. That's kind of backwards. But if you did the research, you know just a little bit of Hebrew, you would know that the word Hamite is not a term that can be used as a blanket term for all of Africa.
Right.
The word Hamite or Ham Egyptian commit is the exact same word.
Exact same.
Instead of a C, there's a K sound. So it's in Egypt is K H. No, in Egypt is K M T Y. In Israel is K H E M. That's how it's pronounced. Same exact word, and it's only talking about Egypt. It's not talking about all of Africa. So from the beginning, your statement of, oh, Hamite sold us to the white man, not making any sense.
Those are East Africans.
And even when right. Then when they run to that, oh, well, even if you're right about that, well, I can't call myself African because Africa is named after Leo Scipio's Africanus. He wrote that off. Still wrong.
Right.
Everybody... Every Hebrew I know owns a book from Babylon Temple.
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of people only read page 38.
Good.
That was the one that was referenced. Right. If they read the book, in its entirety, they would see where Rudolf R. Windsor tells you that the name Africa comes from one of Abraham's grandson,
mm-hmm.
Ephar.
Mm-hmm.
He tells you that right there in the book. He says nothing about Leo Scipio's Africanus. Rudolf Menzler is an excellent researcher, an excellent scholar. He's no way he could overlook that aspect of the story. Not mentioned at all. He didn't mention it. No, he didn't mention it anywhere. It's not mentioned anywhere. You can't find any valid source ever anywhere to put a claim to Africa being named after Leo Scipio's Africanus. When I do research and I study, I don't know what to study. Study my point of view. I study all opposing point of views and to try to prove myself wrong. I did the research. I can't find Leo Scipio's Africanus being credited for the name Africa nowhere.
You received
what
that.
What I do find is him receiving that name or surnaming himself that name after he conquered Hannibal the Great. After he defeated Hannibal the Great, and the people that he conquered in that region were called the Ifar people. The same exact name as Abraham's grandson. And if you go back into the roots, into the comparative studies, comparative linguistic studies of the root of the word Africa, you will see that it's rooted in the exact same word, Hebrew word for dirt or dust. Same exact word. But why is it rooted in the word, Hebrew word for dirt or dust? Because in ancient times, the term Africa only applied to the area that we know as the Sahara Desert today. And what's the Sahara is full of dust. So, fittingly, the name of the land is called, the word Africa literally means land of dust, or the land of dust. And when you go back even further into the etymology, comparative linguistics, it's connected to the word Eretz, too, the word earth, which also has a cognate in the Yoruba language, Eret, which means dirt, dust, earth. Same word. So how are all these languages of people wrong about the origin of the name? But you say the white man is the devil. He's stupid. He stole everything from us. But then you give him credit for naming one of the greatest continents in the world. How?
Right.
Don't go that way. You can't. You're hustling backwards. You can't put that to that. It's that you have so much self-hate within you that you can't come to grips with it. That you're wrong. That's what it boils down to. We have this complex in our head of a adopted child or a abandoned child. You know what I'm saying? That family left them and just dogged them out. Create a block in your head of anything that's pertaining to your origin. You're going to deny it because of the way you felt you were treated.
On top of the conditioning.
Right, on top of the conditioning. You know what I'm saying? So you gotta condition, get the condition off the condition.
That's thick.
You know what I'm saying?
That's super thick.
Yeah. What they call it, is it Jeremiah or Isaiah about the soap? Well, washing. I would say something about washing.
That lie. Yeah, I know something about the.
Yeah.
I think that's Jeremiah.
I think it's Jeremiah. Yeah, so I mean, there's no way getting around it. You don't have an Israelite history without acknowledging Africa. You don't have it. Israel became a nation in Africa, in Egypt. You don't have it. You don't have a biblical history without Egypt. The Bible was put, the Septuagint was put together where? All the Israelites' forefathers, when they got wives, where did they go? Africa.
Time and time again.
So it's like, what are you really, even when you deal with another linguistic understanding, even when you deal with the feud between the tribe of Benjamin and the rest of the Israelites, if you really look at the genealogy. Bible, you're going to see a lot of names of people that these names aren't Israelite whatsoever. Within the kingdom of Judah, so you'll see names that are not Israelite in origin. Why did they name Kush? The Hebrew. In the Hesse. Phineas. That's the Greek way of saying it. These were sons of Aaron. How did it work out?
Pondahesi is Phineas. That's what you're saying. Pondahesi is actually how the translators gave the name Phineas.
No, Phineas is his brother. Pondahesi was a... Oh, yeah, you're right. Phineas. The way you say it is Pondahesi.
That's the original pronunciation.
That's the original pronunciation.
Wow.
The Greeks say Phineas.
Wow.
It's Pondahesi.
Oh,
it means black son of Nubia or Cush. The Hesi. The Nesi. Ta-Nehesi. Like Egypt, you had Ta-Nehesi. Then you had Ta-Meri. So Pet-Nehesi means black or the black son. That's actually a name that one of the more prominent figures in the black conscious community gave. He called me Panda. Well, a lot of people call me Panda Hesse. I changed my Facebook name to Panda Hesse because he was building each other, and he would put on this front of being so anti-Bible, but he really wasn't. He was just mad at the fact that Hebrews were denying the African. That's another issue. A lot of these dudes, they don't really hate Hebrews. They don't really hate the Bible. They don't really hate none of this stuff. They're frustrated with Hebrews in Africa. That's why divine moved through their community with ease. Nobody really gives them flack about it. Not only that, because he can hold his own.
Right.
If they want to talk to them. You don't have to debate his way through everybody. You know what I'm saying?
Not a mother, you know what I'm saying? You can't.
The Torah tell you that. Honor thy mother and thy father. Plain right there in the Torah.
So let's take this a step further back, if you don't mind. Let's go back to the Natufians, okay? Because I think this is an essential link and a missing link that would tie Israel back to Africa. That much more as relates to the Natufian presence in the Levant. Can you talk on that, even if it's linguistics or however you may identify that? I think this is a very important link as relates to our African cultural and genetic dynamic as Israel.
Okay, that's during the what we call the Paleolithic period, when you had thriving, lush, forest, and water running through the area that we call the Sahara. And a lot of people stayed there. When the Sahara began to dry up, people migrated out. Some went east, some went west, some went south. They started to migrate out. All these people stayed within the same speech community, meaning they also would share the same or similar cultures and customs. And when they migrated out of the regions, they already had their language, their spirituality, and their culture fully intact when they migrated to other areas, looking for water and food. The Natufian people migrated all the way to what we call the quote unquote Middle East. Some people say even as far as Syria. Some in Egypt. As well, a lot of historians and geographers, they consider Egypt to be part of the Levant. That's one thing a lot of people don't know. They consider Egypt as part of the Levant as well.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Let me real quick identify what the Levant is, if you don't mind. Some of our listeners may not know what the Levant is. Can you identify the Levant for us, please?
Levant is basically the region that we call who guys can now be, you know, there was no place called the Middle East.
Is that Africa? Is the Levant considered Africa?
Yes. The Levant, Israel, sits on a tectonic plate. The African tectonic plate. Because even when you with Israel as a nation,
Shanti name for their god in Yame, and
Yame.
The Hebraic name for God being Yahweh, that is a cognate, is what you're saying, correct?
I want to say that's a cognate.
Okay. How would you identify
in Yame,
that?
Yame would be a cognate Hebrew for Yahweh. that interesting?
Wow.
But guess what? In the Jewish realm of things, Yom Kippur is just the day of what they say it's for. But in Israel, today, that's the day for daylight saving time. How weird is that?
Language is a even more powerful indicator of identifying a people throughout history as opposed to maybe even DNA. Because I know, like, some things, they look at, like, let's take the Lemba tribe, right? They'll say, well, they have the Kohen gene. Is that something that is more powerful in identifying a people historically, or would you say language change too. If you look at it, you know, we've been assimilated both culturally and even genetically with people. You know, you've had the intermarriages, or not intermarriages, the intermingling of people throughout history, and so the genes get crossed. But language is fixated, is what you're saying, correct?
Right. It's a good way to figure out. We're still speaking and saying the exact same thing we say. And they're more ancient, more, I would say, primitive, more holistic, and not necessarily westernized in the way they, in the ways of their culture. If they're still doing these exact same things and using the exact same things we use, but it's totally different, we have to analyze how to argue. That's why the name of my book is The African Origin of Hebrew Thought and Culture, a comparative linguistic and comparative cultural study.
The name of your book. So, beautiful segue. Tell us about this, man. What is this project that you undertook to do with this African Origin of Hebrew Thought?
One of my biggest inspirations for that. It's a book by a continental African by the name of Modu Adeyeye. He got a hard name to pronounce. studied in the top colleges in America and in Europe. He was a scholar in Hebrew, Greek, Latin, all these different languages. All these languages. And when he began to study, he began to put pieces together of how the languages are the same and that the cultures are the same. So it was so easy for him to pick up these languages. He was like, oh, yeah, we have that word. We say it like this. Perfect example of a cultural word that couldn't necessarily just happen by coincidence that they shared the same word. The word rabbi or rabbi, right? In the Yoruba tradition, one of their chief priests is called rababa. The same exact word, continent roots. The exact same meaning, the exact same application.
No coincidence
whatsoever. Even the word Levi. In West Africa, they called it Lowe. It's spelled almost the exact same way. It's just sometimes the A is substituted for an I or an O. Manuscripts from Fulani rulers from like 1670. said, yeah, we're from Israel. We migrated from Israel. So that made sense. And another kicker is the Fulani were the top people when it comes to, like, the Europeans using them as inroads into the interior of Africa and bringing Africans from the interior of Africa out. The Europeans never made it to the interior of Africa. They never made it. They wouldn't have made it out. So they would send other Africans who they paid or who they were in alliance with to go in, snatch up people and bring them out and pay them as middlemen. The Fulani did that a lot. In that same breath, a lot of them were took into slavery. Were to be a botched deal, or them being confused with certain tribes that were targeted, and them getting snatched up, or them being captured as prisoners of war by the tribes, and them getting sold.
Listeners know you're here with Hebrew Vision Live. We're here today live with my brother JC and Debo Hughes. We're going over the African cultural and genetic dynamics of Israel. We're in the midst of this right now, and it's just amazing to hear this information that the brother's presenting as relates to the linguistic realities, to the cultural and historic realities of the African roots of Israel. And this is some stuff that you need to research yourself. Find out. We're going to put some links in the text box, but I want to continue this conversation with you, Brother Hughes, and just kind of, you know, move towards the end of this matter. Talk to some more about your book, man. So you talked about the inspiration for the book. What does the book entail? What is the premise of the book?
The premise of the book is to put ancient Hebrew culture back into its African, original African context. I'm basically using comparative linguistics and comparative cultural studies. The example, Israel had a thing called the Matzuba, right? The Matzuba were standing stones. And they were used for a couple of reasons. Some scholars believe they were used to represent deceased ancestors. Some scholars were to represent a deity or multiple deities. When they did excavations at certain temple sites in Israel, they would find these matzubas buried in the courtyard. Sometimes there'd be three of them, sometimes there'd be two, or just one big one. We're reading the Bible in the Torah, Yaaqov, the pillow that the stone that he used for his pillow. He erected a stone and he said, this is the house of El. And he called it Bethlehem. Right?
Right.
And not only that, he poured libation to the stone. Mm-hmm. And he anointed the stone with oil. So, looking at that and thinking of how we think today of Israelites, we say, that's pagan. That's witchcraft. Why is he worshiping the stone? Why is he saying that El is in the stone? That the stone is the house of El? Well, Hezekiah felt the same way. Even Moses erected matzubas for all 12 of the tribes. They were even placed over grave sites for Joshua and I forget who else. But I take stuff like that and I go back and I look to West Africa. I found this exact same concept in Mali. Even in, also in Ebola.
So why West Africa? Why do you compare it to West as opposed to like maybe Southern Africa, where some say that's where humanity derives from? Why do you take it to Western?
There's standing stones there too as well. You can even find them in parts of Europe, like what they call understand? So it was his way of, it was, I believe that his intentions were probably semi-good. He wanted Israel to stand out amongst the nations, to be, you know, to be your own finally, to take hold and make your own cultural marks instead of the marks of what your ancestors.
He was a centrist. He tried to centralize the worship
right. Of
the nation.
Right. Right. He had more control over it. Of the economic benefit of it.
Now, would you say that that's a Torah principle, though? When you go back and read Torah, is that not an idea that is as we understand, inspired by the Spirit of Yah revealed to Moshe? Or is that something later with Ezra, who they say, you know, Ezra revised the Torah, he, you know. What's your stance on that?
Right, same thing. Back to Hezekiah, he was said to have discovered the book of Deuteronomy. Right? If you read the book of Deuteronomy, when it comes to the tenets of the law and stuff like that, it almost reads exactly as Genesis. God say the book starts off in the grove. was somebody that came along later wanted to pay because it probably fit the customs of one of their enemies. They said, listen, we can't follow that. We can't have that. We can't have that within, you know what I'm saying, our understanding, our belief. Let's demonize it. Let's say that's the old way of thinking. Let's say that's the gods that your fathers worship on the side of them. You know what I'm saying? This is the way we do it now. That's what we did it then. This is the way we do it now.
So what's your take on that? Do you see anything wrong with that as far as maybe an evolution of consciousness to see, okay, maybe this is something that we can refine. Maybe this is something that, you know, we can codify further and perhaps, you know, apply to us as a distinct and set apart people. You know, being that we're called to introduce the world who we have been revealed to be the true and living creator. Is that something that presents a problem, or is it something that is an avoidance of who we are at our root? You know, what do you see this as?
I don't think that spiritually it presents a problem. Spiritually, it doesn't really present a problem. But historically, it presents a problem.
Interesting. What problem does that present?
It will also present a problem to Israelites who are looking to follow the ways of their ancestors. Because then if you say, well, I'm going to follow the ways of my ancestors, then I'm about to ask you the question of which period. Because the change, are you talking about pre-exilic? Are you talking about first temple or second temple? And so are you talking about the time of the judges, or are you talking about the time of the patriarchs?
Wow. Major differences in those periods, in those epics.
Right. One of the main differences is the office of Deborah, the great mother, you would say.
Okay.
That was a great office that that was put out of same period of those kings coming in and revising everything. Because I believe it was the kingdom of Judah who were doing it. King David, their mothers, sat next to them on the throne.
This is going back to the divine feminine who we were talking about earlier.
Right. And they had just as much power. And the Queen Mother had an office, and in the office they did have a priestess. Africa. But it wasn't until I did a comparative linguistic study, the Yoruba language, I figured out the real meaning of the word. It don't just mean great mother. That's kind of downplayed. It means to be valiant, to be vigilant, to be strong, right? To be all these attributes and words that were just normally reserved for men, this woman had. Our ancestors did guess, or saying, or make up a story of what happened to them. That's one of my contentions with Black Power, not mostly Black Power, the Afrocentric anti-Bible. They have a lot of accusations and assumptions of what happened. And these accusations and assumptions over time were left unaddressed correctly, and it became true. The example, well, the white man came to Africa, the Bible on one hand, gun on one hand, he made you on your knees and pray, and you open your eyes up, you had the Bible, and you had the land. That's bullshit. I'm sorry. Slave preacher, you had two forms of worship, slave
express that, you know, that shows some of our, even our own subconscious or even conscious connection to our Hebrew language due to what the word master in Hebrew means in terms of being the oppressor. Are there other aspects of our culture that relate to that?
I wouldn't necessarily use that. I would say that it's a case of what they call a false cognate, where a word may look and sound the same, but it's not really the same, because the slaves didn't say master because it was a linguistic thing that they did. They said master because they spoke broken English. And the same thing will go for kumbaya. A lot of people say kumbaya is Hebrew. That's not Hebrew. It's it's the Gichi language.
Right. It's pigeon language.
Mix of what they call they call it Creole in some respects. It's a mixture of that language. If you put kumbaya in Hebrew, it would be kumbaya, which means kum is to rise.
Is that like rise in Yah, to rise up in Yah?
Right. But you know the meaning of the song, the words of the song, he wasn't talking about that. That's the thing.
Gotcha.
It's hard to put that into that. But that's something that we do as a people who lost our culture. We try to cling on to things that validate us. That's good, that's what we're supposed to do. We can't cling on to stuff that we can't back up with empirical data. And stand on it. That's why we, Divine Prospect, and the rest of these brothers, we push methodology, you know what I'm saying, textual criticism, all that stuff. We push that stuff. So when people come at us, we're like, oh, we can't critique. When the whole thing came out, people were like, oh, show me the bones of Israelites. Show me the bones of Israelites. Everybody said, show me the bones, show me the prophet bones, show me the bones, everyone the bones. Nobody could produce bones. It took me one book to buy to figure out there was mass burial sites at Lachish in ancient Israel. They had bones. I showed them the bones.
Wow.
What do y'all want to see? It's the bones. Not only did I show you the bones, I showed you the fact that they took these skulls back to analysis. They found out that these skulls were similar or the exact same as Egyptians and Ethiopians. Black people. From the width of the nasal cavities, the eye sockets, the raw ball, everything. Nothing about them here.
They
wanted tombs. I showed them the catacombs of Rome. We have frescoes painted on the wall of Meshach and his brothers, of Abraham and Isaac. You know what I'm saying? You have all these murals, all black. The actual tombs, the actual bones, you got them. We don't have to be scared and revert back to, well, if you go to Deuteronomy, you gotta do that. You want bones, you want tombs, here you go. That's it.
Evidence.
And when you do that, when you're dealing with investigation or court case, that's called a logical fallacy. And that's a way, that's a method that lawyers use. Lawyers and people that have a career of interrogating people use to find out if they're lying. If you're using a logical fallacy, like, I'll give you an example. Hebrew will tell you, if you sit back and debate with Hebrew, and you're making valid points, and all they can do is come back with scripture. You debunk the scripture they have, and they have nothing else to run to but say, well, you don't understand, you don't have the spirit on you. God's not dealing with you. Most God's not dealing with you. That's called appealing to faith. It's logical fallacy. It's a way out of the conversation. You know, it's appealing to faith. A person that's in the faith has questions. When they question a person like that, and the person tells them, well, you don't have the spirit, that hurts your ego and make you feel like that you feel it as a follower of this spirituality. You don't have the spirit that everybody else has, but you don't seem to have. So even if you still have questions in your head, you're going to trick yourself into accepting the fact that it's a lie. It's not true, because you don't want to be the eyeball out. Sit back and take the lies in and not do nothing about it.
That's deep. Now let's wrap this up. We're nearing the 2 hour mark. What's on the horizon for Brother JC?
A lot of work. I'm just working on my book right now. Dedicated a lot of my studies to Ifa, which is the Yoruba form of divination. I don't practice it, but I study it for the cultural, comparative cultural aspect of my book. I'm going to go heavy. I'm going to use them heavily. I'm in that. So that's what I've been really doing. Right. Like, I've been talking to actual Baba Lawus. Asking them, like, how do they operate? Like, how do they perform rituals? How do they, asking them all the questions I would need to do a comparison between how they did things and how the priests of the Bible did things.
You finding a lot of similarities so far?
Oh, man. I can't. We're going to be on the phone for another hour.
Yeah, yeah. That's deep. Real deep. Okay, so you got another book on the horizon.
It's gonna be in the same book.
Wait, so the one that's
gonna be in the same book.
The Hebraic, the African origin of Hebraic thought, that is that not released yet?
No, it's not.
Oh, interesting. Is this gonna be a one volume or two volume book? What do you see this as?
I had enough information to make it multiple volumes.
That's dope, bro.
But I can probably release it now. I don't want to shortchange people. I want to have the information be right and exact. So I'm taking my time with it. It's been like the last 3 years I'm doing it. So I don't want to give people a rush product. Like people, people do a lecture and the next thing you know they got a book coming out. Like, I'm not really with that for scholarship. I like to put like actual work into it.
Okay.
I know Divine Prospect, he's doing he's actually writing actual book for academia, like to go into like colleges and universities, like an actual textbook.
Wow.
So that's the kind of stuff we got on. That's the kind of stuff that we're putting our mark on it. You know what I'm saying? So
that's awesome. May that prosper. So if someone wants to get in contact with you, invite you to do a lecture, make a presentation, how would they get in touch with JC?
The best way to do it is Facebook.
Okay.
Or through somebody that I know, you know me, they reach out to me.
Word of mouth, grapevine. Okay. That's what's up. Man, last thoughts. What are your closing thoughts that you have to share for our listeners here at Hebrew Vision Live?
Thoughts. I would say to the Israelites, we have to be aware of the fact that at the end of the day, the stuff that we're going through with our identity is not something new. From the biblical times, the Israelites lost their identity. You may hear something that sounds like the truth. In the church, and the pastor was telling you stuff, you got tired, you weren't getting fed spiritually, you weren't learning anything, you found out about the Israelites. Guess what? You got elders, priests, whatever illustrious title they want to get themselves.
I want to thank you for your time. Truly, it's been very engaging, very enlightening, intense, challenging. And I appreciate that, man. I appreciate the work that you've put in to present yourself as a workman of this word, rightly dividing it and understanding it, and also presenting us with a paradigm that completely changes the reality of who we are. I know, you know, it can be a struggle dealing with identity in this particular diaspora, in this captivity, as quote-unquote black folk, African-Americans, man. They've done a job on it, you know, so I commend you greatly and encourage you to continue in the vein that you're going on and continue to bring forth the findings that you have for our people, man, because I know that's the ultimate cause of you doing this, is for the people, so I greatly all praise to the Most High for putting that in you, man. So that's awesome.
Indeed. Hey, you also, bro. You also, yeah. Man, you got your blog, newsletter, and you are a member and a part of our research foundation. You're one of the administrators. So.
Yes, sir. Hey, talk about that real quick. Tell people on Facebook what that's about, if you don't mind. What's the name of it again? Best wishes with that. Knock that out. Have a wonderful rest of your night, your early morning. Have a great day tomorrow. Shabbat shalom. Early in advance to you up.
Shabbat shalom.
Happy Kwanzaa. Happy Kwanzaa and happy Hanukkah to you as well. All that good stuff, man. So thank you again. Can't wait to get this out. One love and shalom, shalom.
Shalom, bro.
You have just listened to the rebroadcast of the interview with JC and Debo Hughes entitled The African Cultural and Genetic Dynamics of Israel. I want to thank each and every one of you all for choosing to tune in to Hebrew Vision Live this evening. We will be back next week with another powerful and dynamic interview with Sister Sherry Labor Payne. She is a midwife and a doula here in Kansas City, and she will actually be discussing with us the benefits and joys of home birth. Very, very significant and important topic to discuss as relates to the mortality rate and the overall well-being of our families, particularly that of our children. My wife and I actually had our youngest child at home. And I can tell you from the previous two births that I experienced and the birth that I had at home, you know, the two in the hospital, the one at home, nothing beats having a child at home. And we're going to discuss how this is what we did indigenously, even in the Americas. And so we're going to try to really bring out some of the important principles and some of the understanding, statistics, health facts, so on and so forth as relates to the benefits and joys of having home birth with Sister Sherry Labor Payne, as she calls herself. So, again, come back here next week, same Hebrew time, same Hebrew station here on Spreaker.com. This is your host, Mikhail Corbin Yahu, a.k.a. the End Time Scribe, signing out. Shalom Aleichem. May Yah bless you and keep you, cause His countenance to shine upon you, be kind unto you, lift His face unto you, and give you peace.